All right. Book of Judges. I want to remind you of the theme. We're going to do this pretty much every week just to keep before you so we don't lose sight of why are we doing this? Why are we studying a book of the Bible every Sunday evening? I mean, it's not really a test to see if I can pull this off, though I'm grateful that to this point we have been able to do that, one book every Sunday. It's really to take to heart what Jesus said to the religious leaders in John 5:39-40. You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. It's they, when he talks about the scriptures, he's talking about the Old Testament. It's they that bear witness about me, yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life. Stand with me if you will. I want to read some verses from Judges. I've added a passage, chapter 2, verses 7 to 10. In your bulletin, I'm responsible for the typo in the bulletin. It's Judges 21, 25. But if you want to turn in your Bibles to Judges 2, 7 to 10, and then hold that place, turn over to chapter 21, verse 25. If you can't do that, we're going to have it on the screen for you tonight. Beginning in verse 7. And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great work that the Lord had done for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110 years. And they buried him within the boundaries of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres, in the hill country of Ephraim, north of the mountain of Gaash. And all that generation also were gathered to their fathers. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel. And then the end of Judges, chapter 21, verse 25. In those days there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Sad words, but still the words of what? The inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient word of God. And we're going to see tonight what we can learn about this book and how it fits within the canon of Scripture, and particularly how it teaches us about Jesus Christ, that we might have hope when we live in very similar times as these. Thank you. Please be seated. We told you last week, we introduced the historical books to you. This collection that comes after the first five books, remember, the Pentateuch or the Law or the Torah. And we go from that into the historical books and we broke them down for you. And we told you that that Judges falls into this subcategory of historical books called the theocratic books. Judges is as filled with disobedience as Joshua is filled with faithfulness. When we looked at Joshua last week, we saw this advance. We talked about his military strategy where he cut the land of Canaan in two. He strategically fought right through the middle of it, laying waste, and then fought to the north and fought to the south. He divided the country so they couldn't effectually fight against him as one. And then he died. And it's really interesting what we read a while ago. When we read in verse 10, there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel. What does that remind you of when you read that? Exactly. Yeah. There was a Pharaoh that rose up who did not know Joseph. Remember, and everything changed. And here we have a generation that rises up that did not know the Lord. We talk this morning, we talk a lot in a lot of different settings here about disciple making. We talk about Paul's exhortation to Timothy, the things you've learned from me in the presence of many witnesses, those things communicate to faithful men who will be able to do the same to others also. And when you read this, you have to know there was a breakdown. The generation of Moses passed on to Joshua. Joshua passed on the law to his generation. And we're even told here that not only the elders who outlived Joshua as well carried on. But apparently those who outlived them did not faithfully bring the word to the people, so much so that it could be said that the people who were blessed to see the miracle of the Jordan River parting, the miracle of God winning victory after victory for them, it could be said there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel. So, the book concludes that there was no king in Israel in those days. In other words, they'd had patriarchs. They'd had Abraham to lead them out of Ur of the Chaldees to a land that I will show you. They had had Isaac and Jacob. They led. They went into Egypt to be spared the famine. They were led out of Egypt by Moses, then Moses' successor, Joshua. So they've had patriarchs lead them. But in these days of the judges, these judges are like, they didn't wear robes, they didn't sit in courts. They are really in the form of warriors, priests, to rise up in various localities, sometimes overlapping one another, to lead Israel when they had fallen into trouble. I grew up, I was thinking today, in 1968, which you remember that year, that was a pretty tumultuous year. I was 16 years old, just gotten my driver's license. A few years later, while I was in college, I went down to Florida, to the Orlando area to work. Disney World was in its second full summer of operation. I worked at Disney World for that summer. And in that summer, I got an opportunity to travel different places in Florida when I was not working. And if you remember, it was in Miami, that Miami area, that the Republican National Convention was held. And I drove down for that. I can't even tell you why. I mean, it wasn't because I was politically informed. I just went down there, and it was the strangest experience I'd ever had in my life. The hippies were there, the yippies, the zippies. They were burning things in effigy. They were doing horrible things to material, to appliances and TVs. I went to Flamingo Park, which is where they were camped out. I saw things that this Beaumont, Texas boy had never seen in my life. It was the zenith of the "if it feels good, do it" crowd. Well, that's what you see here. When you remove law, you open a Pandora's box, and all manner of evil comes out. And so what we're going to look at in Judges is really, it's tragedy. In fact, one person said, you could call the book of Judges the book of failures. So let's look at it. Let's watch a video of the Bible Project and their little 7.5 minute or so summary of this book.
The book of Judges. So remember, after Joshua led the tribes of Israel into the promised land, he called them to be faithful to their covenant with God by obeying the commands of the Torah. And if they do this, they will show all the other nations what God is like. So Judges begins with the death of Joshua and basically tells the story of Israel's total failure. The book's name comes from the type of leaders Israel had in this period. Before they had any kings, the tribes were all governed by these judges. Now, don't think of a courtroom. These were regional political military leaders, more like a tribal chieftain. And you need to be warned, the book of Judges is very disturbing and violent. It tells the tragic tale of Israel's moral corruption, of its bad leadership, and basically how they become no different than the Canaanites. But this sad story is also meant to generate hope for the future. And you can see this in how the book's designed. There's a large introduction that sets the stage for Israel's failure as they don't drive out the remaining Canaanites. Then the large main section of the book has stories about the growing corruption of Israel's judges. And the progression here shows how Israel's leaders go from pretty good to okay to bad to worse. The concluding section is really disturbing and shows the corruption of the people of Israel as a whole. So let's dive in and we can explore each part a bit more. The opening section begins with the tribes of Israel in their territories in the Promised Land. And while Joshua defeated some key Canaanite towns, there was still a lot of land to be taken and lots of Canaanites living in those areas. And so chapter 1 gives a long list of Canaanite groups and towns that Israel just failed to drive out from the land. Now, remember, the whole point of driving out the Canaanites was to avoid their moral corruption and their way of worshiping the gods through child sacrifice. God had called Israel to be a holy people, and that does not happen. Chapter 2 describes how Israel just moved in alongside the Canaanites and adopted all their cultural and religious practices. And it's right here that the story stops. For nearly a whole chapter, the narrator gives us an overview of everything that's about to happen in the body of the book. This part of Israel's history, the narrator says, was a series of cycles moving in a downward spiral. So Israel became like the Canaanites, and so they would sin against God. So God would allow them to be conquered and oppressed by the Canaanites, and eventually the Israelites would see the error of their ways and repent. So God would raise up a deliverer, a judge, from among Israel who would defeat the enemy and bring about an era of peace. But eventually Israel would sin again, and it would all start over. This cycle provides the literary design and flow for the next main section of the book. It gets repeated for each of the six main judges whose stories are told here. Now, the stories of the first three judges, Othniel, Ehud, and Deborah, they are epic adventures. They're also extremely bloody stories. Either the judge themselves or people who help the judge, they defeat their enemies and deliver the people of Israel. The stories about the next three judges are longer, and they focus in on the character flaws of the judges, which get increasingly worse. So Gideon, he begins pretty well. He's a coward of a man, but he eventually comes to trust that God can save Israel through him. And so he defeats a huge army of Midianites with only 300 men carrying torches and clay pots. But Gideon has a nasty temper, and he murders a bunch of fellow Israelites for not helping him in his battle. And then it all goes downhill from there. He makes an idol from the gold that he won in his battles. And then after he dies, all Israel worships the idol as a god, and the cycle begins again. The next main judge is Jephthah, who's something of a mafia thug living up in the hills. And when things get really bad for Israel, the elders come to him begging for his help. And Jephthah was a very effective leader. He won lots of battles against the Ammonites, but he was so unfamiliar with the God of Israel, he treats him like a Canaanite god. He vows to sacrifice his daughter if he wins the battle. This tragic story, it shows just how far Israel has fallen. They no longer know the character of their own God, which leads to murder and to false worship. The last judge, Samson, is by far the worst. His life began full of promise, but he has no regard for the God of Israel. He was promiscuous, violent, and arrogant. He did win brutally strategic victories over the Philistines, but only at the expense of his own integrity, and his life ends in a violent rush of mass murder. Now, a quick note here. You'll notice a repeated theme in the main section of the book, that at key moments, God's Spirit will empower each of these judges to accomplish these great acts of deliverance. Now, the fact that God uses these really screwed up people doesn't mean he endorses all or even any of their decisions. God is committed first and foremost to saving his people, but all he has to work with is these corrupt leaders. And so work with them he does. This whole section is designed to show just how bad things have gotten. You can't even tell the Israelites and the Canaanites apart anymore, and that's just the leaders. The final section shows Israel as a whole hitting bottom. There are two tragic stories here, and they are not for the faint of heart. They're structured by this key line that gets repeated four times at the close of the book. In those days, Israel had no king, and everyone did what was right in their own eyes. The first story is about an Israelite named Micah, who builds a private temple to an idol, and that gets plundered by a private army sent from the tribe of Dan. So they come and they steal everything, and then they go and burn down the peaceful city of Laish and murder all of its inhabitants. It's a horrifying story. When Israel forgets its God, might makes right. The final story of the book is even worse. It's a shocking tale of sexual abuse and violence, which all leads to Israel's first civil war. It's very disturbing. And that's the point. These stories are meant to serve as a warning. Israel's descent into self-destruction is the result of turning away from the God who loves them and saved them out of slavery in Egypt. And now Israel needs to be delivered again from themselves. The only glimmer of hope in this story is found in this repeated line in the last part of the book. It actually forms the last sentence of the story. Israel has no king. And so the stage is set for the following books to tell the origins of King David's family, the book of Ruth, and also the origins of kingship itself in Israel, the book of 1 Samuel. But the story of Judges has value as a tragedy. It's a sobering explanation of the human condition, and ultimately it points out the need for God's grace to send a king who will rescue his people. And that's the book of Judges.
Pretty sobering. But it is an image. It has been an image historically. And you can see through the lenses anytime a culture forgets the true and living God, that's what things look like. And it can even perhaps be worse if they knew him and have turned their backs on him. And I think that's kind of where we find ourselves as a nation. So I want us to see, let's just go through some sections here to, you can break Judges up pretty much like he did. I'll use some different language. What we'd call deterioration, deliverance, and depravity is how you move through the book. The deterioration, there's these cycles that take place. He mentioned it, seven cycles of oppression, deliverance, and then depravity. The deterioration begins in chapter 1, verse 1. The summary of it's given in chapter 2. What causes it? They live with the Canaanites. They were not supposed to do that. They were inhabiting the land of the Canaanites, but they were supposed to drive them out. It was not supposed to be a, let's figure out a way to get along. Can't we all just get along? Can't we compromise? This is the history of Israel. It's a warning to the church. When you compromise with the world, the world never comes up to your standard. It will always bring you down. That's why you have admonitions throughout the scripture, like come out from among them and be you separate. Do not touch the unclean thing. How can two walk together except to be agreed? What fellowship does light have with darkness? And so this is the cause of their dilemma. They settle in and live among and with the Canaanites. They fail to complete the conquest that Joshua began, and God judges them for the failure. When you read through the book, it begins with sort of what's been called some short-lived military successes immediately after Joshua's death, but it turns into failure very quickly. They really are struggling with the sense of the lack of a unified leader as they had in Moses and had particularly in Joshua. And no one to systematically, continually, faithfully teach them the law of God. Remember, God said to Joshua, we read the book of Joshua beginning, this law shall not depart out of you, but day and night. And that was gone. Compromise, one writer said, compromise leads to conflict and chaos. And instead of Israel removing the moral cancer, which was the Canaanite culture, they get close enough to it that they become afflicted by the disease itself. The Canaanite gods begin to be embraced by them. And so you have this deterioration going on. That is followed by deliverance. And there's these cycles that go through several sections of Canaan. They do engage in war with the Canaanites, but not depending upon God and not successfully. And so you have the wars that take place, and we're just going to cite them for you here in this what's called the Southern Campaign. And then in the Northern Campaign, the first part, then the Central Campaign, then the Eastern Campaign, then the Northern Campaign Part 2, then finally the Western Campaign. Within this, there are seven apostasies or falling away from God. Each one of these followed by the people being brought into servitude to the Canaanites, just the opposite of what was supposed to happen. And then God raises up in the midst of that a deliverer, a judge, who will deliver them from this. One writer, and I think I have this on here, that these cycles manifest themselves in the sin or rebellion of the people. They fall into servitude, experience retribution from the people they were engaging in war with. The people are broken and realize that they have sinned against God. They found themselves in this situation because they've not followed God. So they supplicate him. They cry out to him in repentance. He delivers a manifestation of a salvation in terms of rescue of them. And then they have a period of peace or rest, a lack of turmoil, a period of silence. And as was shown in the video, it's just a spiraling event. You would like to think that every time they pull out of it, that they might go higher. But the truth of the matter is when they pull out of it, the next time they go in deeper. I want to show you a chart. I think it's the next thing I have. It's hard to read, but I just want to tell you what's up there. This is showing you the cycles themselves, where you have the people who oppressed them, how long that oppression took, who the judge or judges were who were raised up to deliver them, and then the years of peace. Just to kind of, I'll read it to you in case you can't see it. The first is the Mesopotamians, who brought servitude upon the people for 8 years. Othniel, one of the judges, was raised up by God, delivered them from the Mesopotamians, and they had about 40 years of peace. Now, by the way, when you look at the book of Judges, you're looking at about 350 years. One writer said it was 350 years of the Dark Ages in Old Testament history. And then the second you see is the Moabites become the oppressors, oppressing the people for 18 years. Ehud, one of the judges, is raised up by God, delivers them, and they experience about 80 years of peace. Then there's a little parenthesis here where the Philistines engage, and Shamgar, the judge that's raised up, deals with them. And then the next cycle comes when the Canaanites oppress them for 20 years, and Deborah and Barak, you may remember them together, deliver the people from the Canaanites, 40 years of peace. Then Midianites, 7 years of oppression. Gideon is raised up by God, 40 years of peace. Abimelech oppresses them for 3 years. Tola and Jair, you may not remember them, but interesting things happen there, 45 years of peace. Then the Ammonites oppress the people for 18 years. Jephthah, Ibzan, Elon, and Abdon, you see the numbers there, lead them in 6, 7, 10, and 8 years of peace, respectively. And then last, the Philistines again. 40 years of oppression. Samson is raised up, and though he destroys his integrity, in the end he defeats the Philistines, and there's 20 years of peace. And so there's how your cycle goes. That's the book of Judges. When you read it, you'll notice this. But the last section is depravity. There's deterioration, there's deliverance, and then there's depravity. And this is evidenced, by the way, as you read through the book, that they're just going deeper and deeper. They've gone from living with the Canaanites to living like the Canaanites. You familiar with the analogy of the frog in the kettle? You just, and someone challenged this one time, so I've never done this to a frog, so I can't personally testify that this is what happens, but this is what I've read, all right? Just to be clear here, so you don't think I'm cruel to animals. If you put a frog in a pot and slowly turn the water up, that the frog will lie there in the pot and will boil, will cook to death. If you threw him into a pot of hot water, he'd jump out. That's kind of what happens to the Israelites. They live with the Canaanites, and then they live like the Canaanites. They adopt idolatry. They engage in immorality. The things that God said to them, we want you to drive out the Canaanites for these reasons. This is the kind of people they are. They've moved beyond that to finding a way to embrace that and thinking wrongly that they will work that into their worship of the true and living God. And of course, this kind of a culture leads to division. And so the book of Judges ends with a civil war breaking out among the tribes of Israel. And it's a tragic time for them. The need will be for a king. It wasn't necessarily wrong for the people to begin to cry out for their need of a king. What was wrong was they said, give us a king like the rest of the world has a king. When they should have been wanting a king after God's heart. A king with the heart of Joshua. A king with the heart of Moses. And so you have this this bridge that's about to be built. The book of Ruth we'll study next. We'll talk about that next week, where you're going to see where David's family comes from. So the origin of David's family. And then when we get into the 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, we'll look at the history of the kings themselves. A brief discussion of the title. The Hebrew title of the book is Shofetim, which is the plural for Shofet, for judge, or deliverer, or ruler. Any one of these words is the meaning of Shofet. So the Shofetim, the judges. The Latin Vulgate, you should be picking up a trend by now, that many of the names of the books in our Old Testament that come to us in English came from the Latin. The Latin Vulgate is the Liber Judicum, the book of the judges. As I said earlier, though, one fellow said it should be called the book of failures. As far as the author goes, we don't know for sure who the author is. It is conjectured by many sources in Judaism and other corners of the biblical world that Samuel was the author of it. And if not Samuel, then probably one of his students, one of his prophets in training. The Jewish tradition contained in the Talmud attributes Judges to Samuel. And he forms this link between the end of the period of the Judges and the beginning of the monarchy, of the time of the kings. What about the date and setting? One writer said this. He said, if Judges was not written by Samuel, it was at least written by one of his contemporaries between 1043 BC, which is the beginning of Saul's reign, and 1004 BC, which is when David captured Jerusalem. So somewhere within that time frame, about a 40-year window there, the book of Judges was written. The events talked about in Judges, I think there's about 350 years that take place, between 1380 B.C. and 1045 B.C., which if you calculate that out, that's 335 years, but there's a 30-year period that extends in the life of Samuel that's referenced. about the purpose, the theme? Well, part of it, historically, it carries Israel from the death of Joshua to the beginning of the United Kingdom, when Judah and Israel, all the tribes, will come together under David, ultimately. But there's a little more to it than that. There's a theological theme that runs through it. It's the contrast between idolatry, immorality, violence, and Jehovah's covenant faithfulness and being gracious to deliver his people. This is fascinating. When you read Judges, you get some mixed emotions. You think, oh gosh, these people, they were awful. But you see all through it, God continues to deliver. He is committed. This is the beauty, folks. God is committed to his name. And his name is on these people. And while he does not sanction their immorality, their idolatry, their bloodthirstiness, he is committed to bringing these people through this period, because out of the Jewish people will come his Messiah. They have consequences. He lets them go into bondage when they want that. He delivers them when they cry out for that. We see in this God's patient love, his forgiveness in the face of Israel's foolishness, their ingratitude, their stubbornness, their rebellion. And by the way, when they manifest those things, they were always defeated. God never blessed that in them any more than he blesses it in us today. And so the give and flow, the give and take, the ebb and flow you see there is that sin always leads to suffering and repentance always leads to deliverance. And that's a theological picture that you see in a very stark reality in Judges. If there was a time in the history of the earth when a people should have been obliterated and God start over, it was in this period, when they'd seen so much and then forgotten so much. If you're looking for a key word for Judges, it's the word cycles, that life happens in cycles. It does for Israel, certainly. And if you keep this cycle in mind and you read through the Old Testament, when you're looking at historical narrative, that's what you're going to see in the people. When you're reading the Psalms, the poetic books, you're going to see this cycle referenced. You were gracious. We sinned. We repented. You brought us back. It's a cycle that goes on and on. The key verses, I've already read one to you, chapter 21, 25. We'll read chapter 2, verses 20 and 21 to you. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel. And he said, because this people have transgressed my covenant that I commanded their fathers and have not obeyed my voice, I will no longer drive out before them any of the nations that Joshua left when he died. Rebellion always had consequences. And let me say just parenthetically, I'm something of a student of historical theology and God's movements. It still fascinates and perplexes me that when you trace awakenings, spiritual awakenings, particularly that this nation has been on the receiving end of, that in the 1700s, the one key factor that led to what you and I know as the American Revolution was a spiritual awakening where the Spirit of God came down upon this land. Multitudes were converted. Lives radically transformed. It's said that when the awakening came to Wales over in the United Kingdom, when the mule drivers were converted, that they had been so vile toward their animals that they had to retrain them to respond to them. because the mule driver's language was cleaned up, and their animals no longer understood what they were commanding them to do. A kind of a radical transformation that took place. It was the same thing over here. Multitudes swept into the kingdom. And it was that kind of experience of liberty in Christ that gave a climate where the idea of liberty as a people might be achieved. The 1700s. The 1800s, the Second Great Awakening. 1700s gave us the great universities that sadly today have gone away from their path. But toward the end of the 1700s, Yale and Harvard and Princeton, that were all established to be places of higher education to train people about the glory of God. In the 1800s, the Second Great Awakening saw again a sweeping move of the Spirit into the frontier areas even. And out of that came hospitals and orphanages. Culture was radically transformed. And in the 1900s, the closest thing you could identify to an awakening was what was called the Jesus movement in the 70s. But it was nowhere near on a scale as the First or Second Great Awakening. So we went through the entire 20th century without a mighty move of God. And here we are in the 21st century, and still, 17 years in, no mighty move of God. And I just wonder sometimes when I'm praying and I'm thinking about the mighty works of God, why, Lord? Why? Have we as a people of Jesus in the West so displeased you? Have we begun to depend on so many other things that we have lost our sense of utter dependence upon you? One of the great authorities on revival said one time, and it stuck with me, he said, as long as we as a people of God can live without revival, be sure we will live without revival. And so you learn from the cycle here, there needs to come a desperation. And when the desperation comes, God has always been faithful to move. The key chapter, by the way, is chapter 2. I've already referenced that, and I think the video even said you can read chapter 2 and get a real summary of the entire book, of the movements in the book. But let's shift now to where do we see Jesus in this very abysmal picture? You see Jesus in the fact that God, no matter how horrible the people act, no matter how low they sink, when they repent, he raises up a deliverer. These judges were imperfect men and women, to be sure. But they're of different types. Othniel and Gideon were warrior rulers. Eli is a priest. Samuel is a prophet. And so you see these kingly types, these priestly types, these prophetic types raised up. And in the judges, when you look beyond their flaws, you realize that these people were types of the deliverer coming, the Messiah coming. In fact, when you look closely, you see in their roles and relationships the three offices of Jesus Christ. This specificity has been lost pretty much to this culture, but one of the many beauties of catechizing children is there's a section in the Children's Catechism that talks about the offices of Jesus Christ. And he is to us a prophet, a priest, and a king. The Catechism asks how does he perform these to us? Well, as a prophet, he teaches us the word and will of God. As a priest, he sacrifices on our behalf and prays to God for us as an intercessor. And as a king, he rules over us and defends us. It's important for children to get those categories in their heads, to see Jesus as prophet, priest, and king. You ask the children in the Children's Catechism, why do you need a prophet? Well, because I'm ignorant. We'll continue ignorant until I'm taught of the Lord, and particularly just at this point when I'm taught by the Lord. Why do you need a priest? because I'm guilty. I need someone to step forward and atone for me. Why do you need a king? Because I'm weak and helpless. Think about instilling those ideas in children's minds. That I will not know what I need to know until I'm taught by that prophet. I will not stand before God as I need to stand before God until that priest rises on my behalf. And I will not experience life in its strength and vigor in the best sense of that until I bow to the king who rules over me and defends me. And you see these figures in the book of Judges. Jesus Christ is there. He is the ultimate deliverer. Judges' contribution to the Bible, it really shows the failure of the theocracy. And let me remind you what that word means. Theos is God, then ocracy is a form of government. Doesn't mean that God failed, but it means that when they lost their patriarch, a man of God like Moses, a man of God like Joshua, when it was decentralized with the judges in different geographic areas, that they lost the sense of cohesion of living under one God. Judges shows the failure of the theocracy because of a lack of faith and obedience on the part of the people. One writer said this. He said they were disloyal to their divine king and would later find it easier to follow an earthly king. And so Judges stands in bold contrast to Joshua. And I just want to show you a few of those things. I think I have a graph for that now. Joshua, and again, I'm sorry for the, it's so small. There's a lot of words on some. Let me give it, if I can read it to you if I can. Joshua represented freedom. Judges, bondage. In Joshua, we saw progress. Judges, decline. A true backsliddenness, a backwardness. Joshua, we saw conquest through belief. They believed God and marched forward, trusting in him. Joshua, we saw defeat through disbelief or unbelief. Notice the contrast of the language. Joshua 24:16, far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. Judges 3:7. So the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. They forgot the Lord their God and serve the Baals and the Asherahs. In Joshua, Israel served God. In Judges, Israel served itself. They did that which seemed right in their own eyes. In Joshua, Israel knew the person of God and the power of God. Judges, Israel knew neither the person of God nor the power of God. In Joshua, they were committed to an objective morality, the Ten Commandments. In Judges, they've forgotten that, and they embrace a subjective morality. Again, what a subjective, if it feels good. You know, there's a song, I don't know who wrote it, years ago, but it stands out as, if loving you is wrong, how'd the rest of it go? I don't want to be right. It's that mentality. If it feels good, do it. If you can't be with the one you love, love the one you're with. That's very subjective morality, as if there is no standard. In Joshua, you see Israel pressing onward. In Judges, you see Israel spiraling downward. In Joshua, the people judged sin among themselves. Achan is found to have stolen goods, some of the booty, and he is stoned to death. In Judges, sin is tolerated. We'll see some of that in 1 Corinthians, by the way, when we get to chapter 5. In Joshua, the people are marked by faith and obedience. We talked about that in that order, trust and obey. In Judges, the people lack both faith and obedience. There's the contrast. That's the book of Judges in a nutshell. It's not a pleasant book to read, but if you read it looking for Jesus Christ, you will see him shine forth as our prophet, our priest, our king, our deliverer, and the one who loves us with an everlasting love. No matter how far we may go away from him, he has promised that he will always bring us back to himself. Repentance is always the path back to fellowship with God. And I would remind you what John Owen said, because you encounter people, I know, like I do, who basically have the attitude, well, I'm going to sin, God will forgive me. John Owen the Puritan said, while it's true that God has promised to grant forgiveness to all who repent, nowhere has he promised to grant repentance to all who sin. So Judges checks us at our tendency to sin. Judges gives us lenses to see the culture we live in. Truly, we live in the days of the Judges. We're living in what you'd call religious dark ages in the West right now. I'm amazed at the things I read. That there is absolutely no respect for God, for Jesus, for the Scripture, in this culture that looks significantly like the days of the Judges. Okay, any questions or comments before we dismiss tonight? I hope that gave you a good picture of it. And